if I remember the one instruction they gave me to turn on my mic. So, hi. Like you said, I'm Kassandra Perch. I'm Node Botanist on Twitter. I'm an engineering evangelist at RetailMeNot. I'm a JavaScript developer. I do full stack development and robots. And I am an opinionated GIF addict. So JavaScript has a, All right. I was covering up my GIFs, how dare it. JavaScript has a fanaticism problem. And I mean, a lot of languages really have a fanaticism problem, but I mean, I've seen it more and more in JavaScript, especially with Node becoming a thing. And even within the Node bots community, I've noticed some fanaticism starting to arise. And so I felt this is a problem that we should definitely address. And one of the main reasons we should address this is we're truly alienating developers, and not just established developers, but newer developers. I had college students run up to me from my alma mater this year and go, well, what framework do we need to learn to be JavaScript developers? And I just kind of, I felt like Batman. I couldn't handle it. It was just, no, you shouldn't have to think that way. I have a few more examples of the fanaticism. I talk about Flight.js from Twitter a few times. And one of the first times I gave this talk, it was a 20-minute talk, and I sat down after. And about 30 seconds after that, this guy comes, like, it's in a theater presentation, so climbing over the seats to get to me. He sits down next to me, and he proudly shows me his laptop. And he says, look, I rewrote your entire example in Ember in 10 minutes. That proves that Ember is a great framework. Okay, cool story, but that means you missed the last 10 minutes of my talk about Flight so that you could prove me wrong with Ember, and did you really prove me wrong? Another instance, user groups, I see this a lot at user groups, the very much, you're new to this framework, so let me tell you how to do it correctly. I see that a lot, and that's very discouraging. And then I gave a talk at JSConf, and the morning of my talk, which was entitled Modular Architectures in JavaScript, I woke up to an article called Modular Architectures in JavaScript are BS. So you can imagine how much fun that was to wake up to the morning of a talk. The other problem about fanaticism is we're arbitrarily preventing ourselves from writing the best applications and the best code possible by encouraging and participating in these levels of fanaticism. And I'm gonna go over like a lot of ways that that's the case and a lot of symptoms. So three of the most easy to spot symptoms of any kind of fanaticism are Twitter arguments, blanket and universal statements, and dismissive behavior. So I can give you one that fits all three of these at once. It was a tweet directed at me saying, if you don't use promises, you're stupid. I was like, wow, trifecta of awesome right there. Is all three of these things immediately fit in. Don't get me wrong, Twitter is a great place to have discourse. I'm not saying all conversations on Twitter are arguments or are not valuable. I'm saying that you can easily get into one-sided arguments on Twitter when it comes to frameworks or when it comes to specific tools. And with blanket and universal statements, I have very much been trying to eradicate these from my vocabulary. Earlier I was talking about where I work, and I mentioned I work with some of the best people in the industry, not all of them, but some of them, et cetera. So you want to try to avoid these when you're talking about JavaScript as well. And dismissive behavior, just don't do it. Like, just don't. We don't need more of that. The first question I find fanatics really, really like to ask me, no matter what I'm speaking about, is how is X like my favorite? I ran a Node user group for 6 months. There was this one person who would show up every time and ask the same question, and that was, how is this like Rails? He asked me how Johnny Five was like Rails. What? Like, they're completely different uses, but still, even when we did Express, how is Express like Rails? How is Sales like Rails? Which actually was kind of a valid question on that one, but still, it's their favorite first question, is how is X like my favorite? And that question evokes the same reaction out of me every time, and it evokes the same reaction out of me every time, and that's just complete and utter frustration at just the situation. Some of the other symptoms include what I call nail-hammer syndrome. When you have a hammer, everything's a nail. I've seen this a lot with task runners. I love Grunt, I do. I have stickers all over my laptop and other various electronics. I love Grunt. Some people use Grunt for things that Grunt was not meant to be used for. Same with frameworks. If I'm writing a static page, I don't necessarily need Angular. You know, just nail hammer syndrome with these fanatics who just want to use their favorite tool for everything. Maybe even at their own detriment. steep learning curves are something I'm finding a lot, especially with frameworks nowadays, and in some cases, arbitrarily steep learning curves. And we're leaving junior devs in the dark with these. We're saying, like, okay, now that you've learned JavaScript, you need to spend these 2 weeks learning this framework that we use before you can start developing stuff. And not just the good things about the framework, but like the weird parts and the parts that we fight, and oh, here's our custom plugin to get around this particular part of the framework. And there's a complete dependence on some libraries and frameworks that I've noticed recently. And like I said, we buy into this steep learning curve, and it creates this dependence where if we don't have this framework, we don't know how to do stuff. I know there was a huge phenomena, and I know it sounds weird saying it at this conference, but there was this huge phenomena where people knew jQuery, but they didn't know JavaScript. They didn't know how to use query select at all. So if the maintainers of jQuery disappeared tomorrow, a lot of developers would have been, it's getting better now, but it would have been, you know, detrimental to a lot of developers. And especially in Node, what if your maintainer disappears in a go-colored puff of smoke? Fans of Express may have had this sort of dilemma recently. Luckily, another maintainer picked it up fairly quickly, but what if that hadn't happened? Library magic is something I mention a lot, and it's great. It really is. The problem is when you try to do too many things with a tool or a framework, and you make up for that by using a lot of magic, that's cool. But what if you want to do something different? What if you want to change the way that that tool arbitrarily does things? You're going to have to go into the source code for that library. So I'm not saying don't use magic. I'm simply saying be aware of what you need, and if it's going to be different from what that tool or framework does, you need to be ready to handle that, whether it's writing your own tool or whether it's using that tool, but being aware of the situation. I have a thing about the word opinionated. And when it comes to tools, frameworks, whatever, it's kind of been the phrase of the day when it comes to describing new things. The funny thing is, I have opinions too, and the more opinions you have, the less likely our opinions are going to match. And that's cool. It's great to have differing opinions, but when I'm looking at a piece of code, I really want its opinions to match up to mine. So the fewer opinions your code takes or your tool uses, the better. This quick note on language fanaticism. The next time I hear, if we put classes in Java, JavaScript, it's going to turn into Java, I don't know what I'm going to do. No, we're not going to be Java because of classes. We're not going to be Java because of anything that's coming in ES6. Frankly, the only thing that would turn us into Java is actually someone writing a transpiler to Java. Like, I just don't see it happening. And to the CoffeeScript haters, all I have to say is fat arrow syntax. I don't use CoffeeScript either, but all I have to say is fat arrow syntax. But how do we fix this? How do we kind of break away from this hegemony of signing up to one framework or convincing someone who's signed up to one framework, like, hey, there's other things out there? The number one way you can fix this is to start asking yourself questions, not just about what you're building, but about the tools that you're using. Your first question shouldn't be, how is X like my favorite? Your first question should be, how is X going to make development easier, better, faster? How is this going to make my life better? Instead of thinking about how it might play with your favorite tool or how it might replace your favorite tool, think about how a piece of code could teach you something. Think about how you could use it to make your life better. Some other questions you could ask yourself are, am I fully utilizing this? Am I truly taking advantage of everything this has to offer? And that may not leave yourself towards abandoning a tool. There's custom builds for a lot of things, like jQuery, for instance. If you're only using a few things in jQuery, you can easily just go through and use your build tools. What are my pain points, and is this tool causing them? This is the one that I find causes a lot of eureka moments in developers. They'll think about what the toughest part of their day is, and a good half the time, it turns out, oh, it's fighting the framework that I'm using. Oh, it's dealing with this this thing that we rolled ourselves that we have to patch bugs on. When you think sincerely about your day and what your pain points are, you may find that you've fallen into an assumption around a particular tool or framework that isn't making your life any better. Does this tool work well with my other choices? I find this is especially important for frameworks. If there's a framework that you can't use other pieces of code with, or you have to wrap them specifically, or you have to, Flight even has this problem because it's AMD only right now. I have to use AMD in order to use Flight, and that is not necessarily something I want to do all the time. So you have to think about how the tool or the framework that you're using works with your other choices. So new and shiny versus it's not stable. This is a thing I find a lot of pitfalls into, especially, I'm gonna go back to Grunt. When Gulp came out, A lot of people fell for the new and shiny of Gulp, and they immediately just started saying the worst things about Grunt. And that's, you know, like, you're entitled to your opinion, but the new and shiny syndrome I've found is very prevalent in JS, especially, because we've got this overwhelmingly awesome plethora of things being built every day, being premiered every day. We tend to fall into this pitfall of, oh, well, I need to try this because it's new and shiny, or, oh, well, we need to replace our old ailing code with this new piece of code. Well, just because your code is older doesn't necessarily mean it's ailing. Think about what you're doing in that sense. And it's not stable, I found, is the best way to stay with old ailing codes. So it's a double-edged sword here. You can definitely be stuck for instance, we won't upgrade to jQuery 2.0 because we support IE7. It's like, okay, maybe we should think about not supporting IE7 instead, or maybe we should think about, you know, other tools that we could use. So avoiding the developer status quo means don't add something just because that's what you've always done. Don't use something just because that's what you've always done. And I used to fall for this a lot. Even when I was writing this talk, I caught myself falling for using Flyte on a personal project, and I really took a hard look at the project, and I was like, do I really need Flyte, or am I just pulling it in because that's what I always use? So definitely, when you're thinking of new projects and working, even on older projects, when you're using the tools you use on a day-to-day basis, try to take an inventory once in a while and think, am I using this just because it's what's always been done, or is there possibly a better solution to my problem? The number one way I've found to prevent fanaticism is to try new things, because all libraries accomplish something. Not nearly all. I mean, obviously there's some trolling libraries that were written that do nothing, and that's cool and hipstery and great, but libraries that were written for a purpose tend to achieve that purpose. Whether you want it, whether you like the way they do it or not, you will probably learn something. So your first question is, and I get this question a lot in real life, are you saying I should never ever use a framework? And no, I'm definitely not saying that. I would never say that, because frameworks are great. Frameworks are definitely making people's lives easier. I'm simply saying be judicious about the frameworks that you use. Be judicious about anything that you pull into your code base. Think about, and something I said in June that kind of worked out was, is this framework helping me, or is it giving me a gilded cage? Is it giving me this security blanket style of making things easier, but I have to fight it at every turn, or I have to write a custom plugin just to do every little thing? Think about, you have to live with your own decisions, but not just you. If you happen to be a senior developer, if you happen to be a hiring manager, or, you know, a manager in general, your team has to live with your decisions. And that can be terrifying. And so moving to new tools can be terrifying. Having older tools go out of date can be terrifying. But there's some ways that you can easily protect yourself from these situations without having to worry too much about it. One of the things I've found that works for me when I want a new tool is I write the API for the tool I want. I don't implement it, I don't reinvent the wheel, I just say, okay, what do I need? What function calls do I want? How do I want them to look? Do I want promises support? Do I want it to be in CoffeeScript or not be in CoffeeScript? Do I want it to add a step to my build process or not? I write the API and the requirements for the thing I want before I go looking. And that seems pretty sane when you think about it, because when you go to the grocery store, you don't just look, some people do, and I've done this and it's never worked well, is going to the grocery store without a list and just picking up everything that looks good. You get home and you have like half the ingredients for a few dishes and a ton of cookies and chips and junk food that you don't need, and you don't end up with anything you can cook. You end up with like this hodgepodge of things that may not necessarily go together well, but when you go to the grocery store, you think, okay, I wanna make hamburgers, so I need this, this, and this. I wanna make pasta, so I need these things. And it should be the same way when you're starting a new project or even finding just a new tool to add to an existing project. You wanna know what you're looking for before you go find it, otherwise something shiny is going to catch attention and you're going to pick it without knowing a lot about it. A lot of popularity can, you know, drive how you pick tools. And I think we need to move back to like, okay, does this actually work for me and my team? Abstraction layers do not suck inherently. We have a problem with overuse of abstraction layers, and I've received some resistance when I've mentioned them, but they aren't inherently a bad idea. And the API that you just wrote to pick the tool that you're using, use it. Write that API, wrap it around the tool you're using, and then if your maintainer disappears tomorrow, you just find the next one that does something similar and you match it to that API. Instead of having to rewrite your entire application's code, you've created one simple place that you can change that library out without having too much of a problem. I would definitely use this when you're in doubt about the stability of a tool you're going to use. This gives you the excuse to try it, but it also gives you the protection if it fails. Building proof of concepts is something that a lot of people dismiss as, I can just read the docs. It's never worked out for me that way, and I've never seen it really work out that way, of someone reading the docs and automatically knowing everything about a tool or a framework. Documentation doesn't tell you the nasty parts. Documentation doesn't give you the gotchas. Documentation doesn't tell you how well it is to work in a group with that tool. It tells you how well you understand it at this point in time. And documentation isn't always accurate. It can fall behind, it can document features that don't exist yet. So building proof of concepts is a highly overrated thing that I think we should, as developers, enjoy doing. Tools like CodePen make this ridiculously easy, especially if you're testing out a front-end tool. Pull into CodePen, write a proof of concept. One problem I see with people writing proofs of concept is they just hello world it and they call it a day. You can't really do that if you're going to use it in a project that's going to require more of it. Because again, that's like reading the docs. You're just not going to get the information you need out of a hello world proof of concept that you could get when you build an actual one. And again, think about the pain points in your daily life and test those. See if this tool's going to help them or hurt them. Make sure that you're, you know, testing a tool to its fullest, not just comparing it to test driving a car. You wouldn't test drive a car just in a residential area. No, you'd want to take it on the highway, take it, you know, places you're going to go on a daily basis, because you have to live with this decision for a very long time, possibly. And the funny thing about proof of concepts is some people will be like, oh, well, that was useless because I didn't end up using that tool. I usually learn something from building a proof of concept with a new tool, whether it be something about the language that I wasn't aware of, something about the actual framework that it does really well that I'd like to adopt. You usually learn something from building a proof of concept with a tool you've never used before. So give it a shot. It's totally worth it. So I have one last thought, and I'm nervous talking about this, but I'm going to. There's one last piece of fanaticism that I haven't addressed, and that's hiring fanaticism. This problem is easily more pervasive and more of a problem than any other of the type of fanaticisms I've talked about. This is what I mean when I say hiring your drinking buddies. This is what I mean when I see pictures of companies with everyone looking exactly the same. Hiring fanaticism and unconscious bias are a huge problem, not just for conferences, but for companies. And so I wanted to take a few minutes to address it. 56% of women leave tech before the end of their career. Marginalized groups continue to face serious issues getting jobs, getting into conferences, and speaking at conferences. And just about every conference I see, including some of the best conferences in the world, another person from a marginalized group is insulted publicly, and there are very few, if ever, real apologies from the people who commit these. The things you can do to help with hiring fanaticism are learn about privilege. Go watch CJ Silverio's talk entitled No More Unicorns. It was at Cascadia JS. It's one of the best talks about diversity I've ever seen, and I think it would be for you too. Freaking act on it. Hire someone who looks different from you. Now, I know that sounds hard, and I know you're one of the things you're gonna say, not just about the hiring fanaticism, but all the other types of fanaticism is, well, I don't know how I'm going to tackle this problem. Surprise, none of us know what we're doing. I don't know what I'm doing. I admitted that on the first slide of the talk. A lot of people don't know what they're doing. So instead of proclaiming how right we are, and instead of talking about our favorite tools and just clinging to those, let's learn from each other. Let's learn something new, let's build something great, and yeah, let's be awesome. Thank you for listening. I'm Kassandra Perch, node botanist on Twitter, and I'm an engineering evangelist at RetailMeNot. Thank you for listening. Are there any questions? No? All right. Well, if you think of any later, I will be around for the rest of the day. And I don't think I'm hard to spot because I'm kind of colorful. So feel free to approach me with any questions or anything like that. So thank you.